farm down in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. I'm 88 years old.
Old man, by the way.
I'm a career Vietnam era veteran. I retired from the United States Air Force and moved back home to Hattiesburg. And of the 8 kids, my dad had 6 sons, served in the U.S. military for a total of 78 years. And we were born on the farm. We had chickens, cows. That back in the, I was born in 1929, so I grew up in the 30s and the 40s. I know that's a whole history for you all. But I've been around a long time. And later on in the 1940s, my dad, progressive man, this is his picture there. He built a grocery store. So we had the farm, we had the grocery store, and the war was going on, World War II was going on, and the Mississippi economy had picked up. So black folks had a lot of jobs, more jobs,
yes.
And we were an all-black community. So as a result of that, my dad saw an opportunity, and he went out and bought a little sawmill, because we owned quite a bit of property coming out of slavery, okay? And we started to cut lumber for the farms to build chicken houses. And near Hattiesburg was a big army camp during World War II. At one time, we had as many as 35,000 soldiers training to go to Europe. You heard of World War II.
Yes, sir.
And Japan to fight in the war. So the money was coming in and things were going well, okay? And then my dad back at that time was in the mid-40s. He always said, the only way that we can get out of the oppression that we are experiencing as black people, in other words, we couldn't vote, we had to be submissive to the white man, the white, because what? That same attitude you had in slavery, what, was still available then, and we were being denied equal opportunity. And my dad always said, the only way that we're going to get out of this, we have to have the opportunity to vote.
Yes.
Listen to me now, because you all are future voters. And it is important that you go to the polls. When you get to be 17, get over there and find out where you think. And as soon as you turn 18, register to vote and go vote, okay? Because that is where your freedom is. Your freedom is in voting. Because with the vote, you can have an opportunity to what? Pick the people that have your interests. Because as long as somebody else is making decisions on your life, they're going to do what's best for them. So I want you to be real cognizant of that, because we made a lot of improvements during that time. I went to segregated school, and it was ill-equipped. We got books from what? From the white school. That was old. Some of the pages were missing. Right. So you know what I'm talking about. But fortunately, we had a very disciplined environment. We had teachers, some didn't have a college education now. Well, they had college, but they were not graduates. But they were dedicated, and so when you hear me saying that way I speak, I got that out of a country school in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. And I graduated high school in 1948. In 1951, came, well, I went to Oklahoma State for a year. Trav came along, and I went off to the war. And once I got in the Air Force, I had some opportunities that remained there. But going back to my dad, so my dad joined the NAACP. How many of y'all heard of the NAACP? Good. Okay, that's an organization that really promotes freedom for black folks. Okay? And I've been a member all my dad was a member. So think about that. Because what? It's an organization, along with others, by the way, that's dedicated toward equal opportunity and civil rights for us. So, hey, we didn't get where we are just because somebody was good to us. We had to struggle for this freedom that we enjoy today. So don't play with it because we're just like the Canadians and leaders, okay? So my dad joined the NAACP in 1944. And at that time, it was an underground organization. You brought me to the underground? They had meetings in secret. Because if the white society found out that we had black folks organizing now to what? Change things in Mississippi. Hey, they take care of it. Just, you're subject to harassment and even in some cases, even death. So they stayed beneath the surface. But my dad always said, you got to have the vote. when 1950 came along, things starting up in the war, things starting to loosen up a little bit. And by the 1960s, we had the Civil Rights Revolution, and this lady can tell you about that. That's when we had the opportunity. Then President Lyndon Johnson was in office, and he signed the Civil Rights Act and the Voting Rights Act, which gave us an opportunity to vote. When we had that opportunity, how many of y'all familiar with African American politician, a senator, a representative? How many are you? You're in. Where are you from?
Jackson.
Okay. We have a lot of black people in the legislature here now, black senators, okay? And what they make decisions based on our welfare, all right? But also for the welfare of the state. But they are there to what they represent the conscience of the organization to keep things going forward and provide opportunities as well. So your vote is important, okay? Now we got somebody in the legislature that speaks for us. Are we having an opportunity coming out of the slavery?
Yes.
And y'all just finished looking at all the congressmen that we had in senators. But we lost that opportunity. Can't afford to lose it no more.
Yes.
Because when you do, you go back, okay? So as a result of this monument here, my dad was what? During the 1960s, he was out registering the black folks to vote. And the Klan, what? The Ku Klux Klan, they didn't want this to happen. But my dad, along with the whole NAACP, SCLC, which was another civil rights organization, and others, they were here, you know, making this opportunity available for us to go and vote. Vote is important. And as a result of my dad's activity, it had been our folks, African Americans. I know you look at me, I look at a strange kind of like it, but I'm African American, and don't deny it.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
All right.
Do you hear that? What does he say? He's what? African American.
And I don't deny it, okay? Now, if you want to see me as something else, that's your business. But I know who I am.
Yes.
So as a result of my dad being active in the voter registration, then he was identified by the Ku Klux Klan. How many of y'all familiar with Klan? Have you ever heard of it? Let me see the hands. Okay, all right, they're still out there. They're still doing bad things. Okay, but they're not as prevalent as they used to be, but they're there, okay? So what they did, they targeted my dad to what? To be killed. And at the time that they targeted my dad to be killed, he was a very successful man, a business black man in our community. He was a good citizen, never been in jail, respected by whites and blacks, okay? And he wasn't some bigwig, he was just a hard-working black man trying to go forward.
Yes.
And he taught me, my brothers, and I had one sister, by the way, hey, to be law-abiding citizens, do the right thing, get up every day, take care of your responsibilities, take care of your family, and stay out of trouble. And he said, if you just put in jail, don't call me, call God, because I am God. So none of us ever went to jail, I'll tell you, but we knew what that dude meant, all right? And all of us went to the military, came out with honorable discharges, and but as a result of my dad's involvement, the voter registration, the Klan targeted, and the leader of the Klan, Samuel Bowers, all this is something about the he took his group, listen to him carefully now, and they came in at 2 o'clock in the morning. That's the house right there, the remains of it. That's where I was born and raised and grew up on the farm. They fired the cleaning, fire bombed the house, and adjacent to the house was a grocery store, they fired bombed him. And in the house that night was my father, my mother, two of my brothers, and my sister. One of the brothers, my sister was 10 years old, had a brother 12 years old, and then had another brother who just returned out of the army, and he had returned home, he just returned from school, we're honorably discharged, and they was there with my dad in the business. He was in the house that night. The Klan destroyed the house on fire, set the grocery store on fire, and they started the shooting. They came fully armed, they started shooting into the burning buildings. He said, if the fire don't kill you, gamer, hey, maybe these bullets will. My dad was preparing to shoot back because he had been a criminal. beginning. He started shooting back through the flaming building. And as a result, he came along and really didn't have a chance to escape the burning flame. But then he was there too long. And as a result of his sacrifice and shooting back at the ones that were shooting with him, he had a chance to get out, but my dad stayed too long, and he died that same day from the burn. Okay? Go ahead. I don't hear that really.
What he said he burned from the flames.
He burned from the flames. That happened around 2 o'clock in the morning, and he died about 3 o'clock that same day. You see us standing today? That's one of my brothers. All of us were still in active duty in the military. We were defending this country against hostile enemies.
Yes,
and the enemies in our country was destroying our family. And those who had the responsibility for protecting our family, listen to me carefully, for protecting our family, they neglected to do that duty. But my brothers and I had signed an oath to what? Give our life to protect this country.
Yes, sir.
So we were protecting the real, the people who was what? Killing my daddy.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's a hard one to take, I'll tell you now. If you are protecting these folks and they're killing your mom and daddy, that doesn't fit, does it?
Mm-mm.
No, that does not fit. So as we saw, my brother and I were notified. That's my brother George. He'd been in the Army about 6 years. He was a sergeant. Next, another of my brothers, his name is Martinez. He'd been in the Air Force at that time about 13 years. And the third one down is me. I was a master sergeant, and I had been in the Air Force 14 years. And my brother Alvin, he'd been in the Army. So four of us were still on active duty. Two of the brothers already been discharged. Now here we are, had to come home and what? Look at where we were born and raised. I lost my father. My family's homeless. I'm the oldest, so here I stand with a lot of responsibility.
Yes,
but the way I had been raised is, you can't let that old woman, you gotta do the job.
Yes.
So I got busy, got my father buried, news people everywhere, law enforcement, but all that chaos, we had to do the job. And my little sister was burned in that also. So you see the hostility, think about this. Bad people do bad things, but when we have the power to control them, I'm talking to y'all now. Hey, you got to keep these bad people under control, and you have to pay attention to what's going on around you. That means what? Be good citizens, stay out of trouble, like get up and take care of responsibility, go to school, get yourself an education, because the progress we made now, somebody didn't come up and give it to us.
Mm-hmm.
We have to get out and earn this, and that's your responsibility. And boys and girls, I love you, but I want you to really pay attention. This is not something somebody waiting over you come back like Santa Claus. No, as you grow up, your responsibilities increase, and I can see all of y'all being great men and women. We may have another Obama in this crowd,
yes,
and I'd love to see that, okay? So, you have any questions?
Where are your brothers and your sister and your mom today?
Where are they now? Of that group there, and I'm the oldest, I'm the only one living. And I'm 80 in Charlotte. That's what you don't see your family. And the two other two that are not there, one is gone on and one is not with us today.
Right.
So out of these seven boys and one girl, a total of eight, we lost four members of the family. It's only four of us left. Yes, sir.
Are the remains still there, or did you rebuild
them? No. Good question. My mother, who was really my stepmother, but she'd been in our family 65 years. My mother passed when my dad married her. So that's my mother. She's still living, and the house was rebuilt on the same spot.
Mm.
She did not leave. Okay? And she was from Mississippi, but from another community. And she had family in Washington, D.C. Her oldest brother was a dentist, other than worked for the government. So she had plenty of opportunities, you know, to take the young ones and leave. But she said, no, I'm not going. She was a school teacher, by the way. And hey, she grouped it together, and as a result of her staying there, all of us came back home. And she'll tell you now, she's the safest woman in the world. But when all of us got back home and built homes around her, I lived in the community, and five of my sons came back, and we picked up. And I'll tell you this, we have a lot of land in our family, okay? Like 1,000 acres. Now that's probably Greek to you all. But in this case, I own 500 acres of previous state land. And you know, we have cattle on it. But the way my dad raised us, he said the value, hey, is in the land. My grandfather said the same thing. As long as you own where you sleep, nobody can wake you up in the middle of the night and take you out of
the room.
So be independent. That is very, very important, okay?
Yes,
sir. Any more questions?
Well, thank you for
coming. Thank you so much.
We appreciate it. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you.